Hello students, in this video I am going to discuss about the types of the liver. In the earlier videos I have discussed about the simple machines and all the important terms were explained in detail. Levers were also explained. So in this video I will begin with types of liver. Now basically we have three types of liver: first order liver or class 1 liver, class 2 or second order liver, or class 3 or third order liver. Now we will first discuss class 1 liver. Class 1 liver. Now we'll discuss all the levers one by one. In class 1 liver we have fulcrum point in the mid of load and effort. Load is applied on the one side and effort is applied on the other side. Now note that fulcrum may not be in the middle. It can be towards load, it can be towards effort. Now distance between fulcrum and effort is known as effort arm, and the distance between fulcrum and load is called load arm. Now come to the examples of first class lever is a seesaw. Now come to the second class of lever. In this class of lever, fulcrum is at one extreme, effort is at another extreme, and load is situated somewhere between fulcrum and effort. Now again, distance between fulcrum and effort is known as effort arm, and distance between load and fulcrum is known as load arm. Next, the example of second class lever is a bottle opener. Now let's discuss about third class of lever, which is, in third class of lever we have fulcrum at one extreme and the load is at other extreme, and effort is situated somewhere between fulcrum and load point. Now distance between fulcrum and load is known as load arm, and the distance between effort and fulcrum is called effort arm. The example of third class lever is a spade. Now, having discussed about levers, we will calculate mechanical advantage and velocity ratio for a lever. So as we know that for any lever, clockwise movement is equals to anti-clockwise movement. From all given figures we can see that effort is creating a clockwise movement, whereas load is creating a anti-clockwise movement. In class 2 lever we can also see that effort again is creating a clockwise movement, whereas load is creating a anti-clockwise movement. So in all levers there are two movements, one is anti-clockwise and second one is clockwise. So for each lever a clockwise movement is always equal to anti-clockwise movement. From all given figure we have effort into effort arm is equals to load into load arm. From the formula of moment we know that moment is equals to force into distance. So if we consider effort, this is the force, and the distance between fulcrum and effort is effort arm. So clockwise movement will equal to the effort into effort arm. An anti-clockwise movement equal to the load into load arm. This is true for all classes of levers. So now we have clockwise movement means effort into effort arm. Anti-clockwise means load into load arm. Now effort is represented by capital E and effort arm is represented by capital FB. Load is represented by L and load arm is represented by AF. Now taking E to the opposite side, L upon E, and taking AF to the opposite side, so AF will go into the division. Now since we know that we know that MA is equals to L upon E. MA stands for mechanical advantage. So we can substitute MA in place of L upon E. So we'll get MA is equals to FB upon AF. That is, mechanical advantage is equals to effort arm upon load arm. Now let's talk about velocity ratio of the lever. So velocity ratio, as we all know, is given by DE upon DL, where DE is the velocity of DE is the displacement of effort arm and DL is the displacement of load arm. Now we will discuss mechanical advantage for different classes of lever. We know that mechanical advantage is equals to effort arm upon load arm. Now from figure of class 1 lever, we have discussed that fulcrum lies between the load and effort, and I have also told you that this fulcrum can be on the middle, in the middle of the effort and load. It can be shifted towards the load or it can be shifted towards the effort. So if fulcrum is as at that point, so effort arm is greater and load arm is smaller. So for this particular situation, the mechanical advantage is greater than 1, because mechanical advantage is given by effort arm upon load arm. So mechanical advantage is given by effort arm upon load arm. So if effort arm is greater, load arm is lesser, so mechanical advantage will be greater than 1. Now if this fulcrum is shifted towards effort, which means effort arm will reduce and load arm will increase, so mechanical advantage is less than 1. So for first class of lever, effort arm can be equal to greater than or less than load arm. So mechanical advantage can also be greater than 1 or equal to 1 or less than 1. Now we'll talk about second class of lever. In second class of lever, we all know that load lies in the middle of fulcrum and effort. So what happens is the distance between fulcrum and the effort arm is, and the effort is called effort arm. So we can see that from the figure that effort arm is always greater than the load arm, and since effort arm is greater than the load arm, then mechanical advantage for the second class lever is always greater than 1. Now talk about third class of lever. In third class of lever, we can see that since effort lie in between load and fulcrum, so the load arm is greater than the effort arm. Since load arm is greater, therefore the mechanical advantage for third class lever is less than 1. From the above discussion, we see that in some cases we are getting the value of mechanical advantage less than 1. If mechanical advantage is less than 1, then velocity ratio is also less than 1. Now the question is, if mechanical advantage is less than 1, then why these machines are used? Because generally the use of machine is to reduce the human effort. Since mechanical advantage is less than 1, so these machines should be of no use, but still we are using just because when velocity ratio is less than 1, now we know that VR is equals to DE upon DL. Now substituting this, we get DE upon DL less than 1, which means DE is less than DL. On cross multiplying, we get DE less than DL. Now this relation has a very important consequence. This relation shows us that whenever the mechanical advantage is less than 1, the displacement in the load is greater than the displacement in the effort. Now if we divide both these displacement by time, we get dE upon t less than dL upon t. And since dE is displacement and t is time, so displacement upon time will result in the velocity. So dE upon t can be written as VE, and dL upon t can be written as VL, where VL is the velocity of load and VE is the velocity of the effort. Now we can easily understood that velocity of load is greater than the velocity of effort. So now we can conclude that we are using levers whose mechanical advantage is less than 1, just because all the levers which have a mechanical advantage of less than 1 are used to generate a greater velocity at the load end for a lesser applied force at the effort arm. So class 3 levers and some cases of class 1 levers, they are just used because they have greater load velocity as compared to effort velocity. So when a lever has mechanical advantage of less than 1, it is still used just because it produces a greater velocity at the output for a lesser velocity at the input. Thank you. I hope you understand the chapter lever. And thank you.